Let's talk about the second chapter in Business Studies, types of business activities. Now, this chapter coincides with economic systems in economics, the second video in economics that we made. So business activities talk about how the businesses, like what different businesses might be doing, what their size might be, what their motives might be, what they do as a whole. Now, it also depends on where they are and how what their way of functioning is. So the first thing that we're going to touch is stages of business activity. This could be in the primary sector, in the secondary sector, in the tertiary sector. The primary, I'm going to go over A and B very quickly. All right, so the primary sector is going to be talking about where businesses might be involved in the extraction of raw materials and the extraction of minerals and so on and so forth, things that come out of the land. The secondary sector is going to be talking about finishing, adding some value to that by producing something with the use of machines. And the tertiary sector is going to be talking about the sale of that product, or maybe in the service sector. So for example, banking is in the tertiary sector. The secondary sector might be in the packaging of some goods or services. And in the primary sector might be in the extraction of some goods. All right, now public versus private sector. In economic systems, we talk about the three forms of economies, and there's two on both ends of the spectrum. One end of the spectrum is the planned economy, which is run by the government. All the resources and the allocation of resources are in the hands of the government. In the market economy, the resource allocation is done by private individuals through the price mechanism, that is by the virtue of demand and supply. And in between, we have the mixed economy. Now, the mixed economy involves the government and also has and also allows private individuals and firms to make a profit and to run a business in that. So ideally, all economies in the real world are actually mixed economies. Very rarely will you find the opposite two spectrums. All right, now the bad and the good of both are going to be in the mixed economy. So the mixed economy takes the best of both worlds. Some good of the planned economy might be that people have job securities, there's equal opportunities for all. There's not much of a discrepancy between what to produce and how to produce because the government is actually telling you what and how to make it. In the market economy, the good thing is that there's a lot of choice. People have more variety for them and also they can make a profit. The bad of the planned economy is that there's no choice. Right. So again, watch economic systems. The link is below in the description if you're watching this on YouTube. And if you're on IGTV, just keep swiping over to the next video, to the old videos. That's economic systems. The style is economic systems. Now, privatization is the next form of business activity. And privatization is when some government-owned businesses are actually handed to the private sector. That means the firms and individuals. Why do you think that the government might do that? For example, why do you think the government might be sending over or privatizing the railway industry? Because the government can't run it. The government is a little inefficient in running it, so they might just be better off by giving it to some people to make some money off of it and to run it more efficiently and to improve on it, to innovate on it. The good thing about it is that the government can actually make money by handing over something there. So the pros of privatization is that if an industry or a firm goes into the private sector, the profit motive will allow it to become more efficient. Along with that, the fact that there's competition involved in that sector will again allow the firm to perform more efficiently. So that means that there's not going to be much wastage as well. This allows the government to make revenue, they can make money. And then why? Because if the government is selling the electricity, is selling, for example, K Electric was privatized and the government made money off of that. PIA also is partially privatized, which meant that it had to put a bid on it, people had to buy it. When they buy it, the government gets their money, so it's good for them, they can put that money somewhere else. Again, there's no interference from the government in that. There's no ulterior motive for the government when some firms are privatized, which means that politically, it's better off for them because then people will actually have trust that, you know, they're not involved into that decision. The cons are that if a firm is making a loss, that firm will be shut down. So that means people lose jobs. There's a lack of job security over there. Some firms might then start charging a higher price because there is no competition in that industry. They can start acting as monopolies. Monopolizing, I don't think is a word. So, and the next is that private owners will only benefit. Only the private individual who owns the firm might actually benefit from that as a whole. Now, what determines the size of the business? Now, the size of the business can be determined. Now, size, some businesses might be run by one person. For example, I personally do some freelance consultancy of brand and marketing work on digital landscape. I'm the only one doing that, which means that monopolizing is a word. I was just confirmed that by my colleague. So, but let's get to this. I run my own business. I run this on the side. I run Tuition Guys with Faizan. So this is a two-man team. It's a small firm. It's a small venture, right? But some businesses, like you also know, I work at Cedar and Faizan works at Lynx. That has a relatively bigger workforce. Cedar has around 200 employees. Lynx has around 100, 150 employees. So bigger. Some companies might get bigger and bigger because of the number of employees. And also smaller if it's only one man. The output and sale would also determine how much that company is making, how many units are being produced, or how much they're just basically generating in terms of money. Once they sell something, they get money in return. So based on that, it'd be, you know, if you could determine the size of the business. Now, the next point would be capital employed. Capital employed is basically the machinery involved. So let's say that if I'm talking about a sugar mill or steel mill, how many machines do I have to actually produce that steel or to produce that sugar? And lastly, profit. Profit could also determine the size of the business. How? Because let's say that if, let's talk about two different companies like Nestle and Engro. If Nestle is making more of a profit, in some scenarios, it might be considered that Nestle is bigger than Engro because of a profit. They're making more profit at the end of the day. Take a screenshot of this. These are, again, in economic systems as well and in my economics lesson. Quickly take a screenshot, buddy. The business can grow because of three reasons. Number one is because of a merger or integration. Now, that's when two businesses decide to come together, mutually agreed, all right? Now, the first form is horizontal. That means that two firms working in the same industry, making similar products, decide to team up and work together. For example, Toyota and Honda, they both make cars, so they both might decide, hey, let's get together and make more cars together under the name of the Tuition Guys. The second form of integration is vertical integration. Now, this can be forward or backward. Vertical integration basically means that two firms are merging, which are producing goods which belong to the same industry, but at different stages of that production. Let's say fish. All right, so if I'm a fisherman, I might decide to integrate with the firm that actually packages the fish, not sells the fish, but packages the fish. All right, so that means that I'm forward vertically integrating with a firm. So me, supplier of a fish, yeah, the fisherman decides to team up with someone one stage ahead, the packaging of the fish. Now, backward integration would be that, let's say that I am now a restaurateur and I have a seafood restaurant, but I actually want to control my supply. I want to have full control over my supply chain, which means that I'm going to vertically integrate with a firm that actually packages the fish and maybe go one step further back and team up with the fishermen. All right. Now, a conglomerate is another form of integration, which is actually not, well, that's kind of incorrect. But a conglomerate is a firm which might, you know, which is when two firms which make two completely different products and could be in two completely different industries team up together. Like, let's say the fisherman and someone who makes soap. All right, Fight Club reference right there. So a dude who makes soap and a dude who sells fish, they might team up to make a conglomerate. Now, the next form of businesses growing would be because of a takeover. This could be hostile or this could be civil, is when a firm decides to sell itself or a firm decides to buy another one altogether or buy the owners of another firm. Now, the third form of growth could be organic, and that's when the firm decides to slowly and steadily increase its capital, increase its labor, increase its market share, and then therefore grows as a whole altogether. So let's see, the Tuition Guys maybe might grow further on and add more subjects to their portfolio. Now, why might businesses stay small? Businesses might stay small because of a couple of reasons. The first one is a niche market. The niche market is basically when you have a specialized product which might be expensive or inexpensive, but it's very specialized and only a few people are going to buy it. For example, someone who sells yachts, luxury boats. Small amount of people are going to buy it, very wealthy group of people, but again, small amount of people are going to buy it, so it's a very specialized product on its own. Customer care and value. I said earlier that I do brand consultancy and marketing. So I might want to add value to my customers, which is why I decided to stay small and I work by myself so I can give them more value at what I do for them. The next reason might be because of market size and location. Let's say that Walmart decides to open up a branch in some gaon in Pakistan. That now might work because there's a small amount of people there and they might not have that spending power. And so therefore that utility store in that gaon might just want to stay small and not become Walmart over there. Also, another reason why businesses might stay small is because they want more control, they want more autonomy over the way they work, over who they sell to, over their employees, and so on. So these are some reasons why how business activity happens, why businesses stay small, how they grow, what determines their size, and so on. Sorry, I've been sporadic with these videos, but next week we'll have lesson number 3 of business studies. Till then, take care.